Right, hello and welcome to another Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golden from Sales Pop, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM. And today I am joined by Dr. Timothy Clark, who is the founder and CEO of Leader Factor based in Salt Lake City, Utah. How are you doing, Tim?
I'm doing well, John. Thanks for having me.
No, absolutely. And I am, as usual, here in San Diego, and it's actually a bright, sunny day. We've actually had rain recently, so it's been quite bizarre, but there you go. Everything at the moment is a little bit out of whack. So we're hoping when the sun comes out, maybe America can come out again as well. So that would be nice. So what I wanted to talk to, Tim has written 5 books now, I think it is. And his latest book is called The 4 Stages of Psychological Safety, Defining the Path to Inclusion and Innovation. So let's just start, let's baseline this a little bit. What was the genesis of this book, and why did you feel like you needed to bring something like this out at this time?
I think the genesis, John, is that we have two big obstacles in organizations, mm-hmm. and they're related to each other. One is we keep struggling to create organizations that are truly inclusive. We throw an enormous amount of effort and attention and resource at this problem, but we still struggle. And then innovation is the other challenge. And what we find is that the single biggest obstacle to innovation is culture. Mm. And the single biggest obstacle to inclusion is culture. But what is it about culture that's such a problem? Uh-huh. You know, why do we keep running into this over and over and over again? Right.
So when you say inclusion, what do you mean by that? That's a broad term, right?
Yeah, it means that we are not making arbitrary distinctions. Mm. It means that this leads me to my fundamental definition of psychological safety, which is it's not expensive to be yourself.
Right.
Right. You can be yourself in your organization. There's no arbitrary distinction. No one's pushing the fear button based on some characteristic or attribute that you have, or some bias or prejudice or stereotype. So we're clearing the decks of all of that. Now you get inclusion.
Right.
And
right.
What does it take to qualify for inclusion? You just have to be human. That's it. Mm-hmm. and you don't present others with a threat of harm. That's right. That's the only requirement.
Yeah. Well, with the advent of AI and robotics, who knows? We might be including robots in the mix soon.
That's right.
But for now, we're restricted to humans. And it's interesting because I think if you talked to a lot of organizations, they'd probably all say, "Oh, yes, we're very inclusive, and we work very hard at it." And yet, if you talk to the people, you would probably find out that there are still people who don't feel like they can engage fully for one reason or another. Why do you think there's that perception gap?
Well, a lot of times you have people at the top of the organization that are speaking for the rest of the organization, and frankly, they don't have a clue. Mm-hmm. And so that's problem number one. Problem number two is that their psychological safety is a matter of degree. Right? It's not mm-hmm. binary. It's not a binary proposition. It's not a matter of having it or not having it. It's a matter of at what level do you have it? And so in the book, I talk about 4 stages that run from inclusion safety, which means I feel that I fit in, mm-hmm. all the way to challenger safety, which means that I feel that I can challenge the status quo.
Right.
It's a very different level. Mm-hmm. Right?
And so and how would you advise organizations, large or small, to begin the process of building an inclusive culture? Because I think a lot of them would say, yes, this is great. I totally agree with it. And then they would go, well, I don't really know how to start. Mm-hmm.
So I think where you begin is you begin at stage one, which is inclusion safety, and you got to go back and you've got to look at the values and the prevailing norms of the organization. Inclusion safety says that the principle is that worth precedes worthiness. And so if you think about that, that means that inclusion safety, or the right to having an inclusion culture, an inclusive culture, is actually a basic human right. Now, that's something that people need to think about. Mm-hmm. So we owe that to each other. So inclusion safety is not earned, it's owed. And so the first thing that we have to do is we have to do a comprehensive cultural audit of the organization. What are the assets? What are the liabilities? What is getting in the way of true inclusion? So we have to start there. And then we have to remove any of the arbitrary distinctions. And then we have to start implementing very concrete behaviors mm-hmm. that allow us to do that. And that's just setting the foundation, right, John? Right. That's just the foundation.
So how do you do that without then going too far in the other direction and being so paralyzed by the fear that you're doing things that may be excluding one thing or another, and because the parameter, the goalposts keep moving a lot in this area, and so how do you strike that balance so that you can actually have an open and honest culture without it going the other way where you're almost afraid and paralyzed to do anything with your fear of not looking like you're so inclusive?
Sure. Well, and that's where cultures become politicized mm-hmm. and we start coddling and overprotecting people.
Right.
And that doesn't help anybody, because psychological safety is a combination of two things. Number one, respect. Mm-hmm. Number two, permission. So it's those two things coming together. So we have to be reasonable with each other. For example, we're going to make mistakes. But we have to judge people by intent. Mm-hmm. We have to be generous with each other in order to create that culture. And we can't politicize it, and we can't go to extremes. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we're kind of weaponizing that concept, and that's not fair.
Yeah,
and that's 100%. Not fair play. It's not fair play.
Yeah. Right. I like that point, though, about it about being fair. And I think then if everybody who is involved comes at it from a point of view of being fair and fair play and playing fairly themselves, I think then you have the opportunity to create the culture that you're talking about.
I think so too.
Yeah. So talk a little bit about, what is learner safety?
Learner safety is the second stage. So you put inclusion safety, that's your foundation. Learner safety comes next. Learner safety means that I can engage in all aspects of the learning process without fear that I'll be marginalized or embarrassed mm-hmm. or punished in some way. So what does that mean? That means I can ask questions. I can give and receive feedback. I can experiment. I can make mistakes. And I feel free and able to engage in those activities. So that's learner safety. It's a little higher level than just being included. And I need that higher level because my personal exposure and level of vulnerability has gone to another level.
Yeah.
Right.
And you'll never have innovation without learner safety, right?
No, there's no way. No, mm-hmm. you can't do it. And the thing that we understand about learning is that learning is both an emotional and an intellectual process. Mm-hmm. So the two go together. And that's why people have to be protected in that process. Then they're much more willing to engage in the process, because we all bring inhibition and mm-hmm. anxiety to the learning process, right? We all do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so we need some safety in that process. And then we're likely to engage with great enthusiasm.
Well, yeah, because let's face it, the learning process involves often not being able to do something immediately, making mistakes, all the stuff. And especially with adults, we don't like that. We don't like to look like we're making mistakes or we don't know. And that inhibits the learning process. So in order to feel that you can do that, you obviously need to feel secure in the environment. So once you get that, okay, say you have learner safety, your next one is contributor safety. Mm-hmm. So what's that?
So contributor safety is the third stage. And that means that you can take what you've learned and you can use it. You can apply it. You can contribute as a full member of the team, again, without the fear that you'll be embarrassed or marginalized. Mm-hmm. And this is the next natural stage, because after we learn something, after we gain experience and knowledge and skills, we have a natural desire to go learn it, or to go apply it rather,
yeah,
and make mm-hmm. a difference. So what do we need? We need encouragement, we need guidance, and we need some autonomy. Mm-hmm. And then we want to go apply what we've learned. So we want to be able to contribute and make a meaningful difference. Most people have a very deep need to do that.
Yeah. And obviously, if you have gone through and you have come up with great ideas, or you've gone through a process and you want to implement it, but then you reach, or then there's obstacles in your way, or it becomes difficult, or it becomes, as we mentioned earlier, it becomes political or whatever, that's so highly demotivating, right? And it's so frustrating for people who've gone through a process of getting to a stage where they have something that they want to contribute.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So the organization has to try to foster resilience in that contributor safety, mm-hmm. in that stage, because it's not going to be flawless.
Sure.
Right? It's not going to be this unbroken chain of success. It's just not. So we're gonna make mistakes, and we're gonna have failures. So part of it is to separate, and I talk about this in the book, we've got to disconnect failure and mistakes from fear, because they don't necessarily go together.
Right.
And some of the most effective leaders that I studied in doing the research for the book, they successfully disconnect those things. So their people dive in. Their people don't hesitate because of this great fear associated with failure. They've pulled those two things apart.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense. Yeah.
No, absolutely. And then obviously, if you can get to that stage, then see, then your stage four is the highest level, and this is where people feel comfortable in an organization. Challenging the status quo, challenging ideas, pushing back, creative conflict, if you like.
Yeah. This is where it gets fun.
Yeah.
And this is where we give each other a license to innovate. Because if you think about it, innovation really is disruptive of the status quo by its very nature. And so if that's what it requires to innovate, then we need this level of psychological safety so that we can innovate. Mm-hmm. And if you think about it, it really is the culminating stage of psychological safety, because challenging the status quo that's a pretty formidable thing to do. And people don't just naturally do that unless they feel that they're going to be protected in that process. Yeah. So I describe the social exchange at that level as you give me air cover and I'll give you candor.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the social exchange, right?
Yeah.
If you want me to weigh in, if you want me to engage in that creative abrasion where we have ideas that are colliding, then I need some air cover. And if you give that to me, I'm going to give you the candor. And
right.
Now we can really engage.
And what I like about that is, because sometimes people, you know, they get to the stage where they are, you know, feel like they can challenge and everything, but it also doesn't mean that your challenge is going to be the correct one, or your suggestion is going to be the correct one, or that it may need modification. So to your point, you create the environment where people can contribute and challenge things, but they also need to be ready to have their challenge challenged, if you like.
So that's true. And the way that I talk about it, John, in the book, in this chapter, is that you want to be able to participate in that process. Fantastic. But also come being prepared to be wrong.
Yeah.
So you need to step into the arena with that preparation, that emotional preparation, that I'm ready to be wrong. And I'm okay with that. I'm participating. Mm-hmm. And this is how it goes. This is the constructive dissent. This is the creative abrasion. This is the hard-hitting dialogue that we need. And I'm happy to be a part of it.
Yeah, yeah. And I love that. It's true, because it's kind of like, if you're going to give it, you have to be able to take it too. So
that's right.
And, and I think that's where the greatest ideas come from. And then just a little bit, your conclusion, you say, avoid paternalism and exploitation. Just very, very quickly, what do you mean by that?
So paternalism, so if you think about the two ingredients for psychological safety, we need respect. Mm-hmm. And we need permission. Paternalism means that there's a lot of respect, but there's not very much permission. And so It's like a helicopter parent, that pats you on the head and says, don't touch anything. I love you, but don't touch anything. Well, some bosses act like that. Some leaders act like that. They're paternalistic. They think they're benevolent, but they don't want you to do anything. They're not giving you permission. Right. So that's not going to work. And then on the other extreme is the exploitation, where people aren't showing you very much respect, but they want to extract the value out of you.
Gotcha.
So they're exploiting you, but they're not valuing you as a human being. Mm-hmm. So those are the extremes on both sides. Those are kind of the gutters on both sides of the bowling lane that we want to avoid.
Mm-hmm. No, it makes complete sense. To me, because you can say, oh, it's great. Yeah, throw all your ideas my way, but I'm not going to implement any of them. The other one, as you say, is throw all your ideas my way. I'll use them, but I'm, then you can go back to doing whatever you were doing.
That's right.
Yeah, I know. So listen, thanks, Tim. This has been fascinating. So the book is The Four Stages of Psychological Safety, Defining the Path to Inclusion and Innovation. All of Dr. Tim's information will be in his contributor bio and links to his books and his website. But before we go, please do tell people a little bit more about yourself and your organization.
So we're a boutique consulting firm, and we focus on organizational transformation, primarily with culture. And feel free to visit us at leaderfactor.com, or you can follow me on Twitter at Timothy R. Clark, and we'd love to hear from you.
Fantastic. Listen, my name is John Golden, Sales Pop Online, Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. See you all for another expert interview really soon. Thank you.